driving down the Devon lanes with your friends in a Ford Anglia is just motoring and sensory perfection.
So it's a lovely county to live in.
Somebody said a V8 is the ultimate mechanical sound, and I think that's absolutely true.
I just love old vehicles and I love the originality.
It's part of the family.
Part of the family.
Well, I think because I've got a visual impairment, I notice all the sensory aspects of being in a vehicle, an old vehicle, more than most people, because I'm not just looking at where I'm going, although I am, but not as well as anybody else. So everything else comes into play much deeper. The sound of the car, the sound of the exhaust note, the gear changes, the whine of the axle. I could tell you the pale green and white Anglia just by smelling it, you know, and then the van has got another smell again, and it's just what it's made of, the glues, the fabrics and stuff. Driving with somebody, being out in the rally car, just feeling the inertia. You just feel the cornering and the way it goes over the bumps and just the way it handles. I don't have to be in the driver's seat to appreciate all that. I feel so much part of it. And I don't drive, and it doesn't matter. The Anglias are definitely an extended family. There's all the family memories of all the things that you've done in them, the people you've met, like with the Devon Vintage Car Club and the Anglia, Ford Anglia Club, they become really good friends. My dad is 90 now, and the Anglias are the first cars that I can remember him having. Before I was born, worked in a Ford dealership and drove an Anglia through Exeter the day before the launch. He's the technical advisor for the owners club, so we've got it all in the family. And then when I knew that I would not be able to drive, I thought I'd still like to own a car. And my family foolishly said, well, we don't see why you can't. I said, well, I'd like to own an Anglia, because that's what I loved and remembered.
When you buy a classic car, you don't think of the social side of anything. It's a vehicle that you like to start with. You think, oh, I like that particular type of car. But then you join a club, and then the car almost becomes secondary because you meet all...
Say that!
Well,
I know what you're saying.
It's the people you meet and their cars and what they've got.
Croydon, it was made by Sydney Allard, hence it's called an Allard. It's only got a 3-speed in reverse box. It's got a V8 side valve, 21 stud engine. It's all British built, and it's very robust, very tough chassis, loads of good clearance, extremely good road holding. If you're in, you know, mud, ice, snow, whatever, it'll cope with it. You never feel threatened or bothered or worried. We've driven it to Scotland and we drove it to France and we did all that shakedown stuff. And then, to our astonishment, things like the classic Monte Carlo turned up, so we thought we'd got to have a shot at that. I went in for that and I came third in class, and that sounds awfully grand, but a lot of people were a bit too aggressive and they ended up going over the side or going into tunnels with the shades on and crashing it, which was a bit upsetting. So it was hare and tortoise, and I came in third, and I was pretty chuffed about that. I mean, you'd never do ice racing and things under normal life circumstances, but when you've got something that's made for the job, you do it. When you do things like the Chinese and the Monte Carlo, because the Allard has got such history with the Monte Carlo, you do it. So the car has been very much a focal point, hasn't it?
Some of the things we saw when we were going through Russia, which of course then was the Soviet Union, one place we suddenly got on a beautiful tarmac road. And we bombing along, and it's quite wide. And I started looking to one way and the other, and we realised that there were tanks dug into the ground. Only the turret was showing, and this was one of the frontline airfields between Russia and China, and it was incorporated into the road system.
well, you know, you live on memories and do it and worry about things later.
That's a good thing with this club. In the summer, they do monthly runs. Anyone in the club can organise a run. Yeah. So you'll do a round about 40 miles, 35, 40 miles, end up with a pub lunch or a cream tea.
But the other thing you get from the club is all the contacts. Like I was asking you earlier on about collaboration services.
Exactly that.
And all this sort of exchange of information.
Yeah, everybody helps each other.
Yeah.
And that's what it's about.
Yeah,
Absolutely. If you do break down, the second the bonnet's up,
everybody's there to help. That's a good thing about the club, is if somebody breaks down on the road, there's always people to help.
And it's wonderful.
People don't realise just what a nice social life the car community is. You get to meet people regularly at car events, catch up on old friends, make new friends as well. There's nothing wrong with sitting in the field with a cup of tea in your hand. It's always a great way of spending the afternoon.
Standard Flying 8 we've owned since 1976. I paid £19 for that. I restored it over a period of 27 years, so I didn't rush. So since it's been on the road, we've used it. Over 40,000 miles I've done in it since I restored it. You know, I'm not one for modification. A lot of people alter and upgrade their cars, which I can understand and for good reasons, but I like to try to keep them as original as possible. It's more than a car, it's part of the family. The kids have been brought up with it. We've got pictures of my daughter, about 10 years old, stood up in it with her head sticking out the sunroof. And we've got pictures of her daughter in exactly the same pose, our granddaughter. We talk to the car. Linda always says good morning, Edie, and rubs the top of the dashboard when we get in.